He's about 455 yards away. He's going to hit about a 2-iron, I think.
This is the School of Motion podcast. Come for the MoGraph, stay for the puns.
And so, you know, you have to go out and invest in yourself, gamble on yourself, then go out and make short films and whatnot. You know, when you have certain things to show for yourself, especially an audience reaction, then people are taking notice because you'd be like, hey, here are my plans. Here are the things that I want to do. And here's proof that I can actually pull off what, you know, I'm saying. If you're not investing in yourself, how do you expect anybody else to do it?
Film Riot is a YouTube channel with, at the time of this recording, 1.3 million subscribers. It's an incredible resource that teaches you the art and science of filmmaking in a really entertaining way. And the mastermind behind it is Ryan Connolly. Ryan is a filmmaker, and I really think that that word fits him well because after talking with him, it's clear that he is totally obsessed with filmmaking and has been pretty much his whole life. In this interview, we talk about the brilliant model behind Film Riot that lets Ryan and his crew fund and produce short films with an insane amount of production value, all without a studio backing them. We talk about Ryan's process of leveling up that's allowed him to strategically get better at certain things that he knows he'll need when he finally makes a feature film. And we talk a lot about the passionate community and DIY mentality that has allowed Ryan and his team to thrive without giant budgets. There are a ton of good takeaways in this episode, and Ryan is a very interesting guy. So I think you're going to dig this conversation. Let's get to it. Ryan Connolly of Film Riot, is awesome to have you on the podcast, man. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
So I'm guessing like half of our audience is going to be familiar with you because there's a ton of crossover between the filmmaking world and motion design. But for anyone unfamiliar with you and unfamiliar with your YouTube channel and your company, Film Riot, who is Ryan Connolly? What do you do?
Who is Ryan Connolly?
Who is Ryan Connolly?
Let's really get to the core of me.
Yes, in the world.
Exactly. I am a filmmaker and I guess educator, people say. But I started a YouTube channel like 9 years ago called Film Riot, where the idea was always to not be like, hey, here's how you do filmmaking, because I was very green at the time. I had gone through film school. I had been working professionally for about 3 or so years. More than that, like 4 or 5 years. And I had done a similar thing on YouTube on my own. And then I hooked up with Rev3 and then developed Film Riot and put that out with a bigger platform and a bigger audience. But the idea was always, not like, hey, I know how to make films. The idea was always, this is what I do know from my experience so far and my education, but I don't know what I'm doing. I'm going to figure it out with me. And then just putting out ideas and the way that I went about things with no budget, trying to, you know, achieve the goals that I had, trying to make the things I wanted to make, and just having fun in the process and with the hope that it followed me throughout my career in growing as a filmmaker and an artist and, you know, growing my career and figuring out how to get to the ultimate goal of making features, which, you know, I'm getting much, much closer to, hoping that, you know, one day, 10 years down the road, I'm making a feature film, and you could look back at 10 years of episodes showing how it came from absolutely nothing, zero money whatsoever in a backyard to what it is now. There wasn't anything like that. And I thought that would be a great thing to do is, you know, beyond just the educational value of it, the inspirational value of it, because there wasn't anything like that at the time. There wasn't anything online that was really talking about filmmaking as a craft or, you know, really getting into how you, you know, could make a thing that way with very little money. So there was definitely a hole where Film Riot fit at the time. Now there's a billion things like it. Now it'd be much harder to start up a channel like that and it'd be right. successful. But at the time, there really wasn't. There was like a couple of camera review type things and, you know, maybe an After Effects tutorial type thing, like from Andrew. Andrew was already doing his thing, but that's all screen cap After Effects stuff. And then Indie Mogul, who was doing more like props. So there really wasn't that sort of thing yet.
Yeah. I mean, you brought up a good point about, you know, Andrew Kramer. And let's just, you know, whenever we mention Andrew Kramer's name on this podcast, we just need to take a moment of silence to thank Andrew Kramer for all that we have. But I always
call him the godfather of After Effects.
He really is. We threw a party. This is kind of off topic, but we threw a party at NAB this year for all the motion designers there, and Andrew was part of it. And he's, you know, he's MoGraph Jesus. It's like he walks into the room and everyone just gets sucked towards him. He's a magnetic guy. But you know, the stuff that you do on Film Riot, you know, it looks like a pain in the ass to produce. Like the stuff we do at School of Motion, the stuff that Andrew does, I mean, it takes a lot of work, but in the end, you're right, it's screen capping. But the stuff you do, at least sort of the modern version of Film Riot, there's a ton of production value and editing, and it kind of feels like you're writing these things. And so, you know, the level of effort that you put into it, seems kind of like, I'm trying to think how to put this, like, you know, at the beginning, what gave you the chutzpah to kind of put that much effort into something like this when, you know, as you yourself just said, you were still learning? Like, you know, like I think some people have this idea that you can't really teach something until you are sort of a qualified expert in it. Right. And I don't believe that, but I'm curious what, like sort of how you approached that idea. Like, well, I've never made a feature film and I probably won't for 10 years, but, you know, at least I know how to get shallow depth of field. So maybe I'll talk about that. Like, how did you approach the imposter syndrome of that?
Well, I don't want to talk down about screen capping either, because that's not easy to do either. Just making any kind of content that's valuable in any way is extremely difficult. So there's definitely an art that goes into that. And I love that stuff. I mean, I learned After Effects from Andrew and now me and Andrew work together, and it's weird and it's awesome. I mean, in the beginning it was, there wasn't much thought process about that, like the imposter syndrome up front, because I wasn't trying to be something I wasn't. In the opening of Film Riot, when we used to have like a 30-second show open, I was in the open going, you want to be a filmmaker? Well, so do I. Let's figure it out. Like, it was in the open of the show, me saying, let's figure this out. I don't know. Let's go. You know, can we do this? Let's find out.
That's awesome.
I've never had the attitude of, have talked in the way to make it seem like, hey, I know exactly what I'm doing. And if I'm going to talk about something, say, somewhat recently, the place where you put your camera and what focal length you choose, what does it mean? It's all psychological. What are you saying to your audience? And if I put the camera a little bit lower on this type of lens, what am I saying? So we did an episode like that, and I always preface that stuff with, hey, here's my perspective. This is how I see it. This is a subjective thing based off of my experience and the way that I look at this and what I'm trying to convey to my audience. You have to decipher this for yourself. And we've always gone that route. There are more things as I become more experienced and do more things on a much more pro level that I'm a lot more confident in, hey, here's how this is done. But even in filmmaking, there's so few things that are, hey, here's how this is done, period. Like, I mean, a shutter is a shutter. Period. how it operates. Right. That's how it operates. Shallow depth of field is what shallow depth is. Period. But how you use it, you know, what you're doing it for, can shift dramatically. It's all subjective. It's what you're trying to communicate, and everybody's going to communicate differently. So I never had imposter syndrome with that as far as Film Riot goes. The only time I had had it that way is when we were doing something which felt like a little too much. You know, it sounded a little too much like I felt like I was putting it out there that I really know what I'm talking about. And here's how you do that. You know, we're not a guru channel. We're not a, hey, you want to sell a script for $1 million? Here's how you do it. And, you know, it's none of that bull crap. It's like, we're not saying, hey, follow these three easy steps and you're definitely going to be a filmmaker. It's like, to the contrary, we're always saying, or I'm always saying on the show how hard it is, how hard this industry is. And I try to be very honest with that. And, you know, I'm X amount of years into it. I mean, legitimately, professionally, I'm, you know, 17 years into this now, still trying to get a feature made. So it's not easy. Right. And I've always said, if you're not willing to live under a bridge, then not make films. Don't do this as a career. Do something else and do this as a hobby. So, you know, it's those things that have probably kept me from feeling like an imposter, and you know, just putting the amount of effort into it that we did, especially up front. And even now, it's just all, you know, comes from passion. I love it. I love filmmaking. I love discovering new ideas and new ways to do things. It's, you know, it would cost us $1,000 to do this shot. How can we do it for $1? stuff like that. How can we do it with Play-Doh and cardboard? That was something we did last year. It's like, you know, usually you would need all these things. I have a piece of cardboard and I have some Play-Doh. How do we make this work? And it worked. We pushed a bullet out of someone's head, like Wolverine.
That's amazing, dude. The way you're describing it, it reminds me a lot. There's a company that's in kind of our niche called Grayscale Gorilla, and the guy who Nick, he had the exact same attitude when he started that site. It was like, hey, I'm learning this, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to learn something, and then I'm going to show you what I learned, and then you could tell me like if you think that's good or if there's a better way. And it's interesting. It's kind of a new way of having a relationship with an audience where you don't have to pretend you have all the answers. You can be yourself and be honest and be humble. So let's talk about, you know, a little bit of your past. Where did you actually learn, you know, the initial skills necessary to make a film? How to use a camera, how to do basic lighting, how to use lenses?
Well, I think I'm pretty fortunate in that I started this pre-YouTube, you know, before you had a really solid camera in your pocket type of a thing. So everything was really difficult, and I do appreciate that. I've been talking about that a lot recently because I think the simplicity of how easy it is to get your hands on things and accomplish things at a pro level might make it more difficult coming in because it's so readily available and so easy. You don't have to work as hard for it, so you might not appreciate it as much. So I think there's a self-discipline now that wasn't quite, you know, then maybe. This is a new thought process, so I don't know what I'm talking about.
Work it out. It's good.
Let's work it out. So it was, you know, I was like eight. I always say, my mom says five, but I don't know. That's pretty young. But I was around eight. It's kind of a number I just throw out. But it was pre 10 years old for sure. That, you know, my parents brought home the camera, and I very vividly remember looking through the viewfinder. And because I used to do, as we all did, and my other brothers and sisters did too, you put on like little plays for your parents or your other brothers and sisters, and they wouldn't laugh or be engaged in the way that I wanted them to in certain moments. And it just struck me as like, well, they're just not seeing it how I see it. And then I remember looking through the viewfinder, you know, and through this one lens and just thinking that. I remember just thinking like, oh, I can make them actually see what I want them to see only. And just that concept, you know, I was infatuated with it, is that I could take this thing and I could force people to see what I want them to see. Even if I was just, you know, walking around the house filming home videos, I'm still capturing something the way that I want people to see it. And they're going to see this moment exactly how I wanted them to see it. They're going to see the world through my eyes. I mean, I'm sure I didn't think that deeply about it, but that thought process was definitely there. And then, you know, that led to doing that type of stuff, just filming all the time and doing like little sketches and whatnot. But it wasn't until like Jurassic Park, which anybody who watches my show or knows about me at all knows like I'm a freak for Jurassic Park. And that's because at 11, I went and I saw Jurassic Park. And if my parents knew what type of movie it was, they probably wouldn't have let me see it because they were pretty strict. And, you know, it was the first time I saw a movie like that. And it gave me such an intense experience of feeling unsafe in a safe place and completely engaged and truly worried about these characters that, you know, I knew logically were just actors pretending, But, you know, I had to tell myself in the theater, I remember in the trailer, she's alive in another scene. I remember in the trailer, she's alive in another scene. And so when I got out of there, I had to know who this Spielberg guy was that just gave me this experience. And then I figured out what a director was, and I consumed every possible making of or about thing I could get my hands on for Jurassic Park, which back then are just, you know, some promotional books that they put out and things like that of the making of. So it's not too much, but I figured out, oh, it's this director guy. This is who gave me that experience, and that's what I want to do. And that's when I figured that out. And then a TV show called Movie Magic came out later on that was all about process and just showed how they did these major, you know, effects and techniques and whatnot. And, you know, it's obviously something that you can't do as a little kid with a VHS camera and two VCRs. But, you know, I could take those ideas, the idea of forced perspective, the idea of what a green screen was, you know, all of these things, the idea of perspective in general, just shooting upwards and you can make it feel like someone's on a high ledge when really they're only 5 feet up, things like that. And I started putting those into my own little short films that I made with my brothers and sisters, which then, you know, led to me doing videos for like a youth group later on, and then ultimately film school. So by the time I got to film school, I had already done like 20 or 30 of my own little short films.
It's crazy because you literally just described my childhood. I was almost identical to that. Like,
yeah,
I remember,
it's like we all have a very similar, like everybody I talk to, they're like, yeah, dude. And I'm like, did you do VCR to VCR? And they're like, yes, I did.
Yeah. And my parents had the fancy VCR that had a slow-mo button. So you could like shoot something, play it on that VCR in slow motion, and then videotape the screen. And that way you could get, because I didn't understand how to edit at that point, but I would do it in camera. I would just like shoot that with the camera so that it was kind of nonsense.
Man, that's fancy. I would get like explosions and stuff from like TV because they put the movies on TV and we would record them on VHS, of course, like everyone did. So I would take like what was that movie with The Stakeout, I think it's called, with Richard Dreyfuss. And there's this big like house explosion. So I would take those little moments and then I would film someone running away from the house and like jumping and then cut to that explosion. So I would do stuff like that, like intercut things in.
That's hysterical. Yeah. And I was always obsessed with special effects. And I remember, you know, like for high school films, getting a green, you know, bed sheet or something and like hanging it on the wall and doing the poor, desperately poor man's green screen and, and all that stuff. Yeah. So
it and like half and, your body was always missing. It just did not work out.
And you know, and it's funny because now, you know, I mean, to anyone listening who's, I guess, probably in your 20s, it's hard to imagine that a computer used to not have the power to actually like ingest video. Like you had to buy these really expensive cards. Anyway, that's a rabbit hole. But okay, so you were basically obsessed with making films from a young age, like a lot of people. And so you had experience at least with cameras and maybe rudimentary editing and all that kind of stuff. So then you went to film school. And it's funny because I went to film school too. I ended up switching. I didn't love film school, but you went to Full Sail and you finished the film program, right?
Yes, I did. I was looking for a place that was like a quick turnaround tech school. I didn't want somebody to tell me how to tell a story. I didn't want somebody to tell me what the story meant. You know, as I was looking into all these colleges, it just, a lot of it felt like it was somebody was going to tell me what a film was and should be. And I just didn't want that. For better or worse, I didn't want to taint what would ultimately become my voice. I wanted to discover that on my own. So I really just wanted something, because I you know, I had talked to a few people already and I had kind of an idea of what I wanted to do and be and how I wanted to go about it. So I wanted something that was very much a, hey, here are the buttons. And then I would get out of school and really figure it out. Because I think that's what you do no matter what. You go to school to learn enough to be able to come out of school and start really learning. Because you really only learn by doing. And that's why nowadays it's like, do you even need film school if you're not going for networking? Because there's so much information online. You can get all that information, you know, either extremely cheaply through, you know, a couple sites that offer it or free. And then just learn from experience. No one's ever asked me if I went to film school or cared, you know. So I definitely, you know, I really liked going to a school that didn't dive into those things. So there is value in diving into those things for sure, but that's not really the path I had wanted for better or worse. I don't know.
Well, that's interesting to me because, you know, you said that you went there because you wanted someone to tell you what buttons to push, right? And how to, I don't know, how to get more out of the image that you're creating with the camera and the lights and all that stuff. Right. And I guess, like, you know, maybe 10 years ago, that had some validity to it because there wasn't just like this easy way to learn that stuff. I mean, even back then, you know, like maybe even 15 years ago, you could get books and stuff like that. But now.
Yeah. And this was like 16 years ago, I think 14 years ago, something like that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I graduated college 2003. That's scary how long ago that was. But
which is insane. Oh, I was going to college when you were graduating.
Yeah. But anyway, my point was that you know, now to learn how a camera works or what different lenses do or like what different lighting setups look like, you got Film Riot.
On YouTube, type cinematography, boom, there you go.
Yeah. But to me, that's the easy stuff. And there's a similarity with motion design where everybody gets into the game because they want to, quote, learn After Effects. They want to learn how that program works. But that doesn't actually make your work good. Then you have to learn how to design well and how to tell stories and how to animate well and stuff like that. So there's the technical side. But then there's the, you know, it's film, it's an art, and there's a lot of theory and things there. So since you didn't learn that at Full Sail, how did you learn that stuff?
I learned it how I, you know, want everybody else to sort of learn it is to think for themselves, watch the films that they love and start to dissect them, start to think about the stories you want to tell. Why do you want to tell them? Why do people do the things that they do? Dive into psychology. It's one of the reasons I'm not a huge fan of video essays is, you know, it comes off very film schoolish. The things that I didn't want to happen in film school, I see through video essays is, you know, mm-hmm. you have somebody coming in and dissecting subjectively a film as if it's objective fact, and it's just not. It's how you saw the film. And oftentimes you can even cross-reference that with, you know, the director's commentary of the film that they're talking about and find that the director didn't actually see it that way or mean it that way. It's not, right. not that they're wrong. It's just how they see it. But you have kids looking at that and be like, oh, this is why this is why the only way that you do a camera, you know what I mean? It's, I don't think that's super helpful because then you're just becoming a copy of how somebody else sees the world or sees storytelling or art. So for me, it's watch the films for yourself, dissect them for yourself, turn off the sound, see what they're doing, pay attention to life, think about the story you're wanting to tell, and then work that backwards. What does this mean? Why are these characters doing these things? What am I trying to say? Do I want to say that loudly or do I want to say that quietly? And what does that mean? You know, dive into, you know, photography and painting, other arts that you can dissect in different ways, that will then, you know, translate over to the art that you're trying to create. But that's how I've always gone about it. And I mean, more than anything else, it's been about dissecting and learning about actual life. And then that moves into my storytelling as a filmmaker.
Well, and it seems like the way that you have done it, I mean, I'm not super familiar with what the modern, like, you know, journey of a young filmmaker looks like, but you've made a lot of short, very short films, you know, like 5-6 minutes. Mm-hmm. Is that your way of sort of like flexing those muscles and kind of building up those chops rather than trying to spend 2 years making like one really long feature film or something?
Yeah, I didn't see a lot of value for me personally in putting all my eggs in one basket and spending all this time making one film that in the end I'll learn from this one project. For me, it's, you know, I see the end goal where I'm trying to get, you know, I need to get to the end of that tunnel. But to get to that end of the tunnel, I need all these notches on my belt. You know, I need to know what it's like to work with an actual stunt team, actual actor, cinematographer, you know, this sort of gear, that type of gear, in this scenario, that scenario, you know, this type of visual effect moment, this type of special effect moment. So there was a lot of like experience I wanted to gather for myself, which is like I was saying, you learn enough to go out and get the experience to learn the rest. So for me, a lot of these short films is me being an entertainer, wanting to entertain you for whatever that period of time is. With most of them, I'm not trying to say this big message, you know, I'm not trying to tell you this super in-depth story where there's always something there for me, but it's always that it's whispered. It's not yelled at you. And that's right. what gets me interested to, this is why I'm putting the camera here, because it means this to me. And that's in everything I make, but not everything has, you know, something that's being, you know, really vocalized. And, you know, that's been okay to me because that's not what these were supposed to be. They were pieces of entertainment that I was using to educate and to gather experience for myself. So, you know, over a period of time, I have all this experience and all these things as if I made, you know, three different feature films now with the experience that I've been able to gain from it and the people I've been able to learn from and work with, to where, you know, now I'm at the point where I feel very, very ready to, you know, go and direct a film. And even if that's me making the film for myself, thanks to all the short films that I made and the experience that I've gathered, I know how to do that. You know, it'd be great to, you know, I'm going to be pitching pretty soon. It'd be great if, you know, one of these pitches were picked up by a studio, and because that would be a huge learning experience as well. But thanks to all the short films that I've done, and, you know, a lot of, because a lot of people online are like, why haven't you made a feature yet? Why haven't you, you're way beyond ready. Go make a feature. And I'm always trying to be, say, you know, I'm not though. And everybody follows it up with, well, you're never ready. It's like, okay, yeah, you're never ready to get married, but it doesn't mean you're going to get married at 17. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you can know to some degree when you're ready enough to not be ready to actually do it. You know what I mean?
Right.
So of course I'm never going to be ready to actually do it, but I'm ready enough. You know, I'm not unready. So it's like, you know, now it's at the point to where I wouldn't be wasting people's time. I know how to bring this together. I can confidently say, hey, you know, we're going to have something at the end. Who knows what it's going to be, because, you know, you never really know. But, you know, now I can bring everybody together and know that I'm not wasting everyone's time and that, you know, I won't drown in the process. And I learned that early on when I reached way too high, because with every project I do, I'm reaching a little higher than I should. But it, you know, it just takes a bit of a leap. It's not so high that I can't even get there. And that happened one time and financing fell through. And, you know, a lot of people that were wanting to come to this project already invested a ton of time in this project. It just didn't go through and they had wasted their time. And I didn't want that to ever happen again. So it's been very important to me to make sure I gathered the very specific needed experiences to now confidently move in to do those things. So that's really what all those short films have been. Every one is a strategic choice of, this is the type of short film I'm going to make now because I need to get experience in this way. Some of them have just been, you know, a zero budget thing like Sentinel, where I was working with a fully CG drone the entire time, which, you know, I'd done some stuff like that, but not to this degree. But mainly, Sentinel was done as a way to create this action scene, basically, without any prep whatsoever, and just have a very loose script and then walk on to this location that we found with $0 and a couple of people and just make it up as I go. And can I, you know, piece this together to something that's confident and entertaining in the end? Because that's what happens when you're on these, you know, it happened in Ballistic. You're on this huge 85 person set with all these crazy stunts happening. It was like nine people in this action scene, all in different perspectives, all happening at the same time, this chaos happening, and you're running out of time and you have to throw out all your plans and you have to make it up on the spot with an 85 person crew, money on the line, 7 cameras rolling. And that can be very difficult. So there's been things like Sentinel in the past to where I purposefully chose not to prep anything and use that as practice of, can I go in and piece this all together and it be coherent in the end?
I love how you've got a process for how you're building up your, not just like your skills, but also your confidence. There's some similarities here between what you're doing and motion designers. There's this idea that a lot of times artists do called a 5-second project, where you just animate something for 5 seconds. And that's where you try something that you've never done before. Like, hey, I'm going to try and hand draw a flame, you know, like flickering or something.
Right. Yeah.
And because if you wait around for a project where you need that, then you're going to be terrified to do it. You're not gonna be very good at it. Like I was going through your YouTube channel and you have a short it's just called Hallway Fight. And that's exactly what it is. And it's great. It's really, it's well done.
I figured, why give it a name beyond what it is?
Like, You know, yeah, exactly. It's very obviously, it's like, you know, you practicing directing an action scene.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming that then I know nothing about ballistic. And by the way, for everyone listening, we're going to link to all of these films in the show notes, so you can go check them out. And most of them are not very long, so you can watch, you know, probably Ryan's entire filmography in a couple of hours. But
yeah, pretty much.
But ballistic is your most ambitious one that at the time of this recording isn't out yet. By the time this episode gets released, it might be. So let's I want to come back to ballistic. I want to stay in the past just a little bit longer. What was your first like professional gig you know, as a filmmaker, as a, you know, I'm assuming it wasn't as a filmmaker, because that's typically not what you get paid to away. But what was the first time someone paid you to do this?
I did some like local commercials and stuff like that before film school. So there was that type of stuff. And then after film school, I did the same sort of thing. And then this actress hired me. I think she gave me like $2,000 to do these like scenes. She wanted to do like 3 scenes, to make it look like she had been in several films. And I was like, well, I'll just take the $2,000 and I'll put all the money into getting gear and, you know, us making 3 short films. Let's just make 3 short films. So we did that, and they weren't great, of course, but it worked. She got what she needed out of it. And, you know, I was able to practice as well, and I got a small light kit out of it. And then I took, you know, that gear, and I went off and did a bunch of free stuff, and then created a reel and a resume, and then put that out there. I always tell a story because I just think it's funny. It was, I got fed up because I was doing construction work, and I was doing tech support, and I did stocking shelves, and I washed cars. I did you name it. I had like 2 or 3 jobs at one time at one point, just trying to build up my gear so I could do free work on the side to hopefully eventually be able to do it. So I did all that, and I built up my gear pretty well, and not much was happening. So I worked real hard and offered everybody I knew, hey, if you need a commercial, if you need a music video, whatever you want. I had a few friends that were in bands, so I would just shoot them at, you know, their shows, and I'm recording and whatever, and just created a reel, and even did what I did with that actress. I just would shoot these little scenes to make it look like these full short films, and ways to practice as well. Created a reel. And then just spent like a week sending my reel and resume to, I think it was like 150 plus companies all over the place. And literally one company got back to me, which was Alienware.
Not a good ratio,
which is what was so funny. What's so funny about the story is, you know, it's not like I had a bunch of options. It was literally one company was like, oh, hey. And they were in Miami, which is something that really helped me out because I was local, and they were looking for someone who could do everything from pre to post production, which also helped me out because I could do that. And it was funny because I didn't even send it to them. I sent it to this production company, and Alienware was asking them, because they work with them every now and again, hey, do you know anyone? They're like, well, funny enough, this guy just sent us his resume. So then I ended up getting that job, and I ran their video studio. I was the only one. The video consisted, the entire crew, video crew consisted of me. So I just did all of it, and I was able to help build the studio, and I had my own office and studio and all this freaking gear. I had like 3 cameras and, you know, a jib and a huge psych wall and all this stuff. And it was just me. I was the only one there. So if I wasn't, you know, checking off the boxes that they needed me to do that day, I got to experiment, which a lot of it was experimenting with their stuff they didn't even ask me to do, where I would just take whatever the new product was and come up with a bunch of like cool visuals and then show it to them like, hey, check it out. And they used a lot of it. And, you know, I learned a lot of techniques doing that. And, you know, other times I would just, you know, practice visual effects stuff, do, you know, tutorials from Andrew and things like that. And I just learned a lot at that job, just doing the work that they needed me to do, which was usually talking head stuff, and then going above and beyond and trying to hone my craft overall to their benefit, but also to mine.
So what you were was basically a generalist. And, you know, it's funny because I remember like when I came into the industry, like 2002, 2003, there was still this really big split where you were either production or you were post, but it was kind of weird if you did both. And now it's like totally normal. Like every company has a video person, right? Mm-hmm. That sort of shoots and edits and does all that. Right. So that sounds really awesome. Like you kind of fit you were kind of early in that game, like being able to shoot and edit and do all of that. So did you start Film Riot?
Yeah, well, they just didn't want to pay multiple people. That was the thing. I didn't get paid the salary of four guys. I got paid the salary of one guy. I just had to do the work of four guys, which always ended up, you know, around the busy times, like the holidays and whatnot, always ended up me bringing a pillow to work because I would be there for like 2 or 3 days straight sometimes trying to get it all done.
Were you, while you were there, you know, sometimes like if you're in a job where what you're producing during the day isn't very creatively satisfying, you go home and you try and do your art then. Like, were you doing that or were you actually getting opportunities to make kind of cool stuff over there?
I mean, of course, but I've always looked at it as like, I didn't get a lot of opportunities to make cool stuff, but I made my own opportunities. I made like a web series there without asking. Sort of the Office-esque. And that was back when YouTube would feature stuff and it featured it a bunch of times. So Alienware finally found out about it and they're like, yeah, keep doing it. So
nice.
I did that. It was like a little comedy series. It was fun. But mostly I would just find ways to, you know, keep myself interested and try things. You know, so if it's like, hey, we're doing a talking head video, instead of just throwing the cameras up like I always do, I would shoot it different every single time. I had three cameras, so I'd tried to make it look like, how can I make it look like three operators with one dude? You know, so I would just,
right.
I would take my shoes off and be in socks, and while they're talking, I would run from camera to camera doing moves with each of the camera individually to make it look like. So then I would try different ideas with post-processing. You know, maybe sometimes it was black and white, or some of them was black and white, or maybe show the gear in this one, which is kind of a normal thing now, but at the time wasn't. You know, it's like, what if I, you know, show the gear, show the behind the scenes elements of shooting this along with, you know, the inside of it elements. So even when it was just a dumb talking head thing, I was always trying to find a different way to light it, a different way to shoot it, to, you know, practice and learn from as well. So I was always creatively, you know, satisfied to some extent with all that stuff, because I just wouldn't, you know, rest on what I've done a billion times before. I would try to find different ways of doing it. And then, of course, the second you leave there, you know, I'm working on my own stories, writing scripts. I had Frameforge even back then, so I would write scripts, and then I would board out the whole thing in Frameforge and just look at my movie in frames, because, you know, I didn't have my own gear or time or money to make anything, or anybody to make it with at the time, other than my brothers and sisters, which I would still do. I would, all, over the weekends, I would go and I would make like a cute short film with my little sister, who's now like 18 and awesome and works for me. But back then she was like, you know, 5 or whatever it was. And I would have, you know, I called it the cookie caper, and she's trying to get a cookie when her mom said no, that sort of stuff. And just practicing, you know, the coverage and the pacing and how it unfolds and all that stuff, just doing stuff that was just dumb, but I got to practice with. So I was always doing that stuff. I was, you know, I've never not been doing it. I have to. It's, you know, that's another thing I always talk about. It's like, it's not a, I want to do it. It's like, I can't help, I have to do it. Or you start getting a little depressed. So it's definitely a piece of me that needs to be fulfilled continually. It's like, you're never not hungry. It's like, you can't consume this enough. It's, you're always hungry.
I think that, I mean, that makes a lot of sense. I think that's one of the reasons that you've, you know, people have been drawn to what you've created and you've been successful with it, because you've paid your dues, you like put in the time and done your reps. So were you working full time at this gig when you started Film Riot?
Yeah, I call those the dark days. I was working full
time.
Yeah, man, I was working full time for Alienware, and I started doing this, which was also a full time job, because I was brand new to making fun. Now we've got a definite groove on how we do things. Like, we try to switch things up a lot, but even when we switch things up, you know, you have a method and a procedure of doing these things to where you can do them much quicker. Much more experience. So we'll knock episodes out now in like a day or two if we have to. Whereas back then, no way. Everything was
right.
A learning process. I was figuring everything out as I went. And, you know, it was definitely a different type of show back then. There wasn't any shows like it. There wasn't any shows like how we even did it back then. How we did ads wasn't a thing back then. Like, it was, you know, how we did custom ads. Because I was like, man, if I have to put an ad in the middle of my show, I'm going to make it a sketch. And we did that. So it was all this, like, you know, process of discovery. So it would take a full week to pull off every single episode. And so it would end up being something where I shot on the weekends, and then throughout the week I was editing and doing the visual effects or whatever it was. And then at least once a week, I always bring this up because I'm just scarred by it. At least once a week, I would go 2 days without sleeping fully.
Oh my God.
And it would happen every Wednesday night, which would turn into Thursday morning. I would hit export or upload rather onto the Rev3 server, and I would change and drive to work to Alienware. And it happened every single week for months. And it was just, no matter how hard I tried, there was just no good. It just, that's what happened every week. It's like, how is it to the last second every single week? At most, I would get like an hour nap in. So I ended up discovering Newton naps back then, where you would sit in your chair and you would have a spoon and you'd hold the spoon to the side of the chair, and then you would just let yourself doze off. And then once you kind of doze off for a second, the spoon falls, hits the ground, wakes you up, and you had like a little micro nap, and it actually would help. So when it would like get too much, I would do a little Newton nap and then keep going.
Dude, that is so up my alley. I'm going to try that. That's amazing.
Do it. Do it.
Never heard of a Newton app. So what kept you going in those early days? Because that sounds really hard. And I'm guessing that, you know, YouTube channels, even back then when there weren't as many, still took time to like get traction and stuff like that. So were you getting positive feedback, or were you getting fan mail? Like what kept you doing that?
Just the passion of it, man. It's like, you know, we were in Florida and it was all disconnected, and I wasn't used to like forums or anything like that. I wasn't really that type of person that was in that stuff so much. It was, you know, I just watched and made movies as much as I could, pretty much. And the YouTube comments were there for sure, and that was nice. Really, it was just, I just loved doing it. And the second I got done with one, I had an idea for the next one, and I just couldn't wait to try it and shoot it and mess around with it and see what I can do with this lighting idea and that lighting idea. So it's always just been the passion of it that pushed it forward. And of course, once the community started being built over, you know, a few months, because we had a decent audience up front, thanks to Rev3. I was doing some stuff before. I did like a show before. We actually showed an episode on Film Riot. It was called Making the Film. It was so, so terrible. we were doing that first, and that did okay. That was anywhere from like 10,000 to like 40,000 views per episode, which back then was pretty solid. And that also got featured a few times. And I think that's how Rev3 found us. I can't really remember 100%, to be honest. So I was already doing that, but that only came out every couple of months. It wasn't like I was doing it weekly. It was maybe one a month. So, you know, I had already been doing that, and that got a couple of like, hey, this is cool. And you're like, oh, somebody likes it. Cool. Let's do the next one.
There you go.
Yeah. You know, it was a lot that, I think. And in the beginning, they weren't really putting the episodes on YouTube. They would just put snippets. And I had come from doing YouTube. That's what I knew. And I could see the views on YouTube, and I could comment with people on YouTube. Whereas they did like the Rev3 player, and that just wasn't the case. So I was a big advocate from the beginning of like, hey, let's go on YouTube. Let's put this on YouTube. That's where it's going to live. You know, nobody wants an independent player. Let's go where the community is. So finally, when that happened, you know, I finally started really feeling the community a lot more, and that was a lot nicer. Really, it's just been, I just always just got to do the next thing once I finish whatever this thing is.
So was Rev3 like a separate site that would just host the videos on their own site?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Gotcha. Okay, cool. So that helped you get a little bit of exposure early, and then you switched to YouTube, which is just allows for a lot more organic growth.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I mean, we started doing YouTube like right away, but it would just be like, we would upload like the sketches and things like that.
Gotcha. So then what was the transition like to turn what was initially like this passion project into something that actually was generating revenue and eventually let you leave your full-time gig?
Time. we had ads on the show right up front, but it just made no money. It made
like YouTube ads or like the sponsors, your custom ads,
yes,
that you were doing?
Customs. That was like first episode. Yep. We had custom ads in it. But it just made zero. zero money. So it was a very long time before it really started making money. And even when I quit Alienware, it wasn't because I was making enough money to quit thanks to Film Riot. I wasn't even making nearly enough money. I was actually hoping to get fired. Dell bought Alienware and then a bunch of people got fired with great severance packages. And I was like, oh my God, fire me, because they fired both of my bosses in my department. Like, one was a photographer and the other one did like motion graphics and web and stuff like that. But they were my bosses. They were my managers. They fired both of them. And I was like, I'm going to get fired. Yes. Because it would have given me a few months to figure it out. And that's what I was really trying to get. And they didn't. They didn't fire me. They kept me on.
Bummer.
So I finally, you know, I felt like I got to the place where I felt like I was standing still. And for me, standing still is going backwards. You know, there's only, you're always going in a direction. And I just felt like if I didn't, you know, pull the trigger and get out of there and commit and, you know, gamble on myself, it was just, I'm going to get comfortable and then this is never going to happen. And that's right. The worst thing ever. And so, you know, practicing what I preach, I'd rather live out of my car or under a bridge than not do it. I, you know, was planning to live out of my car. Because I just didn't have money. So that was going to be the plan. I set my trunk up to be my dresser. It was going to happen. But my friend caught wind of it and let me live with him for a while, which if I would have told my parents that, they would have killed me and they would have been like, are you nuts? Come home. But for me, is, you know, I left home a long time ago and I've made my own way. And I feel like if I go there, am I going to get comfortable? Is that going to be going backwards? And I just felt like the more hardships I could put on myself, the harder I'm going to work, the faster I'm going to run towards the direction I want to go. So, you know, I didn't want to do that. I just wanted to make it very hard for myself so I wouldn't get comfortable and I wouldn't stand still at all. But my friend let me sleep on his couch, which was uncomfortable. So I was like, okay, it's better than a car, but it's still uncomfortable. Let's do it. And then, luckily, I really lucked out with, I landed this job for AMD creating a few videos for them, which sustained me for, like 6 months while I figured out how to boost Film Riot a lot more. And then just kept bringing in little client gigs here and there when I needed them to sort of sustain while I continued to build Film Riot, which took a few years to become sustainable on its own.
I like that you sort of lean into that resistance, you know, that fear. Because it's something that I tell a lot of our students, you know, when you start down the path of becoming a motion graphics artist, there's going to be a lot of dark days where you really don't think it's going to happen and you're just not good. And that's when you really have to like lean into that feeling and just hug it.
Totally.
Just be like, yeah, this feels awful. Oh, and because that's how you grow, you know, and it is good motivation.
Yeah, I feel like that's kind of every day a little bit.
Yeah.
I feel like every day I have moments of, I'm the worst. This is never going to work. And hey, this might work.
I'm a fraud. Yeah. Yeah, I hear you, man. So what does the channel look like now? I mean, I just checked. You've got, at the time of this recording, 1.3 million YouTube subs. So you have like the little plaque in your office, right? You got a million subs. Don't they send you like a cool like plaque or something?
Yeah. Yeah. We have the 100,000 sub plaque, which is smaller and silver, and then the million, which is bigger and gold.
That's awesome. So now I'm assuming that, so what I've heard from other YouTube channel, you know, personalities and creators is that you used to be able to actually make okay money monetizing your YouTube videos with ads. And then at some point the algorithm changed, something changed, and now that's gone. So how does Film Riot sustain itself now? Because it looks like, you know, from the outside, you've got an office, you've got people helping you with this, you know, I'm assuming you're paying them. So what does it look like now? What's the business model?
So, I mean, it's never just been Film Riot, you know, like, hey, here's my income. It's Film Riot. That just wouldn't be sustainable. Film Riot got to the point to where it was definitely a very nice leg of that. Never solely the thing. And, you know, that came from my dad always telling me, you know, you want to sit on a stool, you're not going to want it to just have one leg. You're going to fall over. You need as many legs on that thing as possible.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah. And you know, I took that to heart, and that's what I've always done. I've tried to always have as many things going on as possible. So at one point I had, you know, Film Riot and a show called Film State and my show, another show that I produce called Variant, which is still online. And that has like 1 point something million followers as well, and doing client work and doing, you know, appearances or, you know, speaking engagements or, you know, like stuff behind the scenes for other people or little VFX pieces for other people or consulting or whatever it is. Always be doing something. And now, you know, it's to the point to where I do very little client stuff, but we have our store. So we still sell assets and classes and, you know, our films, which really you're buying the special features, which has tons of on-set stuff and really in-depth looks at how we made it and things like that. And that's, you know, a big revenue side for us as well. So we have the shows and that going on and any client stuff that we do here and there, which is very few and far between. And really just a part of the show now. And it's really just collaborators, people that, you know, I always tell my collaborators I'm a terrible negotiator because I'm like, hey, I'm making a short film. Do you want to put some money into it? I'm going to be honest. I'm going to say and do all the things I'm going to do for you either way, whether you give me money or not. But if you give money to the budget, we can make it look even better, which will make you look even better. Because it's like, you know, right. I'm going to use Adobe Premiere no matter what. I'm going to say the stuff I'm going to say no matter what, because that's what I use and that's what I actually think. And I'm going to use, you know, After Effects no matter what, because that's obviously what I'm going to use and say and think. And, you know, Canon cameras is the cameras I'm usually using. So, I go after those people to collaborate with us, but that's not really income when we do short films. I don't make any money off short films. I lose a lot of money off short films. Because the collaborators come in to help us, you know, bring the budget up, but I always end up putting at least, you know, a quarter of the budget in myself. And that, you know, it's not the best business model, but yeah, I look at it as investing into our future, you know, the future of Triune, the future of me as a filmmaker. And then, you know, we try to sell that stuff, like I was saying before, like the film packs with all special features to hopefully recoup what we put out, which we're usually able to do, and or it's usually a minimal loss, which I think is a worthwhile investment. You know, to answer your question more directly, we still put ads in the show. The big change was, we used to do 2 ads in the show. Now you can't, you can only do 1. And, I'm glad that happened to be honest, because I watched some of the old episodes with 2 ads and I'm like, holy crap, this is just like all ad. It's just way too much. So now looking back on it, it was just way too much advertisement in 1 episode. So now we just do 1, but we still have sponsors that come in. Domain.com has been a sponsor for us for forever. I like have that sponsor read memorized down pat.
Right.
But they've been a big supporter of ours for years, which, you know, obviously I'm really appreciative, and I that's what I use for my stuff too. So it's like, even that stuff, if I don't use it, I don't really put it on the show. Or if I, you know, don't like FreshBooks, I don't really personally use very much anymore, but I did at one point and I really like it. So they're one of our sponsors as well. So we try to keep it organic like that. And that always seems to help as well, and brings ways to bring in revenue without it being counterproductive. But really it's just a little bit of everything, the store, our shows, any outside work that we do, stuff like that.
It's a really cool idea. And it's something that, you know, I've thought about trying to do it for School of Motion too. And it's kind of what you're doing, where what you really want to do is make films, right?
Yeah,
and,
exactly.
And, unlike motion design, and this is something I want to talk about in a little bit, like motion design, I can sit down with enough coffee and all by myself make a 2-minute fully animated thing.
Totally.
Right? Like that's possible. But as a filmmaker, you can't do that by yourself. Like, and not the level of stuff you're doing these days. You need a crew, you need people, you need gear, you need locations, you need actors. And so that stuff costs money. And what it sounds like what you're doing, at least partly what you're doing, is you're funding the film by selling the making of the film, which is brilliant,
yeah.
I think, right? Was that, like, did you come up with that idea, or did it just kind of work out that when you're like, holy crap, this is a good idea?
Yeah, it's just how I came up with how we could, you know, make what we wanted to make and entertain people the way that I wanted to entertain them in the way that I wanted to without anybody being involved. Because, I mean, you could do branded content and I could make a short film that's branded content like people do. But now that company has say in what my short film is, and that's not acceptable to me. I'm not trying to make an ad for you. I'm trying to make a piece of entertainment for my audience. And, you know, so being able to sell into, I mean, what they really need anyway is the making of, like, hey, here's how I made this thing that you love. Because, you know, it's like when I see something that I really love, I want to see how they did it. I want to see what they used to do it. I want to see their process behind it. Their, you know, what were they thinking? Why did they choose these things? So, I mean, that's more valuable for everybody involved, for, you know, our collaborators like Adobe, who's, you know, products I really believe in, and our audience who I want to connect with the products I really believe in, because these are the things I use because I think they're the best tool for the job. And, but not only that, why I use it this way, not that, hey, here's this, you know, camera I use. Great. Who cares? But here's why I use it and how I use it. You know, so it's, you know, the marriage of those things I think has become the most valuable all around. But yeah, it just came from, I want to make sure films we need to bring in. And Film Riot was definitely a part of that thought process of just doing Film Riot, having ads in there, and then constantly promoting like Adobe and Canon, because it's what I used. I wasn't connected with them yet. And then eventually over time, getting connections with them. And, you know, I have this catalog of just loving them. And they're like, hey, this is clearly, you know, it clearly makes sense for us to connect. So stuff like that.
I love this like new model and like the way that you're kind of, you know, crafting your career and building skills while sharing that knowledge with others and using the making of to sort of fund the film itself. That's a new model that didn't exist, you know, not that long ago. So if you had done the other thing, like if, you know, your other film school friends, I'm assuming didn't go start YouTube channels and sort of do this, right? They probably moved to LA and did it the old fashioned way. What is the old fashioned way? Like if you had wanted to be able to direct something like Ballistic, you know, it's, I think you said it's like 17 minutes long or something, a crew of 80 people. How would you get the opportunity to do that without doing it the way you
did? I mean, like a studio system, right? I mean, the path to that studio system isn't exactly, there isn't one, you know, it's not like one. That's one thing that I've learned, you know, after creating my own network and having friends out there and everything, is everybody has a totally different story. I mean, it's similar in certain ways, like ours is, you know, it's, our beginnings are very, very similar and everything like that. But how people got there are just is so totally different. You know, one person started from just PAing and then moved into cam op and then moved into some cinematography, which moved into directing and music videos and commercials and viral videos and then short films, and all the while he's pitching places because he is in an agency because of the commercials. So he's pitching all the time, and then a pitch gets picked up, and then boom, he's making movies. Then you have somebody like David Sandberg, who's just in Sweden making his films with his wife, and one takes off, and James Wan and company comes a call, and now he's making Shazam for DC three movies later in 3 years. So it's like, you know, everybody seems to have a totally different path in, but I mean, that's it. You're going about the studio system. You're asking someone to let you make the project. And, you know, that's something I didn't want to do up front, especially not having any experience or knowing what I'm doing at all. I wanted to learn with me being the boss and the final say of everything, for better or worse. I'd rather me be wrong than you be wrong. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know, but I mean, obviously now I would love to, you know, do a studio system sort of gig and learn from those people who this is what they do and are just insanely talented and knowledgeable. You know, it's at that point now that where I think that would be a great next step. But, you know, starting, it's not really, it wasn't, I don't think the most beneficial starting. But if I were to have gone that path and gone to like LA or whatever, it would have gone that direction probably, you know, like PA and then work from there. Some people start at a rental house and, you know, they're just very personable and they work well with the gear and they figured out every piece of gear. And then, you know, you had the cinematographer and gaffers coming in there all the time and doing gear tests or whatever. And they got to know them and you're just really hard workers and passionate and competent. And then people see that and they're like, hey, you know, why don't you come out and be on my camera team? And then now they're on the camera team and they're a camera PA and now, and then they're a second AC and then they're a first AC and then they're a camera operator. You know, there's paths like that. That probably would have been the one I would have taken. I want to be a director. So I probably would have gone the route of like, you know, PA to AD sort of situation. Or, you know, who knows, maybe some small production company where I get to, you know, direct some small commercials and then build up that way. But, you know, it definitely would have been something like that, starting at a much smaller level, helping other people make their things and, you know, slowly moving into being able to make yours.
Yeah. Again, there's like a corollary between that and the world that I came into of post-production where, you know, the traditional way to become, say, like a commercial editor used to be you have to go work for a post house, let's say in like New York or something. And you start as, you know, like the receptionist or, you know, the whatever, like just the gopher, like going and getting muffins for the clients. And then if you're lucky, then you can be an assistant editor and you can be an assistant editor for like 10 years before you ever get to be called an editor and all that kind of stuff. And or, you know, what some of my friends have done is they make some short film and they edit it or they edit something for free and it goes viral and it gets them noticed and then boom, they're an editor. So you can kind of like swing for the fences approach too.
Yeah, that's definitely the thing. Like even if you are a PA or if you're, you know, you have to show something for yourself, whatever it is. If you want to, like you were just saying, you get stuck in assistant editing job for forever. Cause that's the, you know, these people will see you as that, whoever it is. And it's just human nature. It doesn't make them bad. They're just, this is what this person does, is what they're good at. It's who they are. And, you know, they could say they want to be a director till they're blue in the face. Everyone wants to be a director. I feel like a director or an actor or a screenwriter, everybody wants to be one. It doesn't mean everybody can be one. And so, you know, you have to go out and invest in yourself, gamble on yourself, and, you know, like your friend did, and go out and make short films and whatnot. And that's even one of my friends who was doing the music videos and the viral videos and pitching. It wasn't till he made this short film that did very well that really things took off. But I mean, there was a ton of stuff happening behind the scenes, but it's, you know, when you have certain things to show for yourself, especially an audience reaction, then people are taking notice because you'd be like, hey, here are my plans. Here are the things that I want to do. And here's proof that I can actually pull off what, you know, I'm saying.
Love it. It's like do the thing that you want to get paid for before someone will actually pay you for it. And yeah,
exactly. If you're not investing in yourself, how do you expect anybody else to do it?
Yeah, that's the quote right there. That's the quote of the podcast.
I did it. So, nailed it.
Yeah, you did it. I love it, man. So let's talk about the difference between the way that you make your films and the way that it would work in a studio situation, because your channel teaches people how to get production value that normally. Well, I don't know if it's, I think things have probably changed, but like, you know, when I had my first internship, I was astonished by the scale of even a very small production. You know, one day of shooting interviews could cost, you know, $20,000 in rental and crew and location and whatever. But you show how to get that same look, that same production value with, you know, way less expensive cameras, less expensive lenses. You can build a dolly out of a shopping cart, you know, whatever. When you get to the next level where, you know, you're doing something for a studio, does that ethos have to change because now there's millions of dollars available?
Yeah, to some degree. And I mean, a lot of it's bloated and, you know, not needed and it's just the way of things. But to some degree it changes, but I know a lot of people that are still, you know, gaffers and grips are DIY dudes, you know what I mean? They have a truck full of things and they'll just whip up whatever you need on the spot. So, I mean, that I don't think that attitude will ever leave, you know. It's to bring up David Sandberg again, with his first two films, he did a lot of VFX and even shot some stuff when they told him no because he needed it for his film. So he just did it. He just made it happen. And this is in a studio film. Yeah. So, I mean, that's how I hope I would be. You know, you're just making the best project you can possibly can, however you're making it, whether it's with an Alexa or a Blackmagic camera, whatever it is, you know. It's always the talent that goes into the thing, not the tools involved. Obviously, the tools involved make it a whole lot easier. It's a lot easier to screw something into a really thick plank of wood with a drill than a screwdriver, but the screwdriver will get the job done. It's just going to take a lot longer and it's going to hurt your hand. So, I mean, that's really the difference to me. So, you know, all the gear and the massive crew is really nice and frees you up to really just concentrate on the creative. But you can still get it done either way. And I'm really glad I came from that school of thought for so long, because it really does build your sort of your toolbox of ideas and solutions to where, you know, on Ballistic, it served me very well of, you know, we, we were trying to pull off a lot of gags per day, just a lot. We needed probably three more days than what we had, at least safely. And especially because of the budget, I think my stunt coordinator told me that the entirety of the budget that we had for the entire short film, including what we ended up shooting in Texas as well, was less than what I would have had to pay for just the stunt team and special effects that we had for 3 days in LA. And that's not counting the rest of the crew, cast, gear, location, visual effects, post, pre, all that stuff. So when you're working with those limitations, you know, so many things don't necessarily, it's not necessarily that it's going wrong. It's the inevitable hiccups from, you know, those restrictions. And, you know, coming from that world, it's very easy for me, thankfully, to think quickly into, okay, here's what we can do instead. And I know it'll work because I did it before this way. Somebody get me bubble gum and popsicle sticks, stat. We can fix this.
Right, MacGyver.
Yeah. I'm really happy it came from that sort of thing. Cause I do still bring it into this world. And there's been a few projects where I've made quick choices like that, where people are like, really? That's what you're going to do? And I'm like, trust me, it'll work. And then it totally does. so it's really nice to have that sort of thinking, even on the bigger sets so far. I mean, I've only done a handful of them.
Yeah, that kind of hacker mentality. Well, let's talk about Ballistic a little bit, because that's the biggest, you know, thing that you've done to this point, and I can't wait to see it. So, like, first, why don't we start with this? Like, how, you know, a 17-minute film, 80-person crew, stunt coordinator. I mean, to me, if this was like, you know, one episode of a Netflix show or something, I would assume it cost $1.5 million, right?
It did not.
Yeah, I assumed it did not. So I'm curious, like, if you can say what the budget was or a ballpark or something, but how did you make that work, like, at that scale for so much less than it would have, you know, taken, you know, in a normal studio situation?
Yeah. I mean, it was about a tenth of that Netflix show. We needed I think three times what we had is what we kind of figured without really sitting down and doing the crazy math of it. You know, it works that way because everybody's just passionate about it. Thankfully, I have a body of work that I can show for myself and be like, hey, if you like this, you know, I'm doing this now. And if you're down to come on board and, you know, people have seen how I've done my BTS in the past, and I'm not me, 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 I. I think the auteur theory is nonsense. It's bullcrap. It's non-existent. It's impossible. You have people with a stronger vision than others, but it is impossible for one person to make a film on that scale by themselves. Hitchcock, Spielberg, anyone.
Right.
No one's making the movie by themselves. There's a cinematographer. There's a sound designer. There's a composer, all putting their fingerprint on the thing. A writer of the film that quote unquote auteur is making. It's, you know, it takes a village to raise a film, and that's just true, period. It's just some people have a much stronger and specific vision. And I've always been, you know, I've always tried to point that out heavily. This person brought in these ideas. This person did this. That person did that. This person was so amazing. I was so lucky to work with this person, because it's just true. As a director, half of your job is bringing together the most talented people you possibly can to make you look way better. You know, you have this cast and even as a writer, I have this cast that I'm bringing in and they're acting their pants off and they're making me look better as a writer and as an acting director. I have the cinematographer that's making me look better as a visual director. And of course, I'm definitely very specific in where I want the camera, how I want things blocked and paced, and what I want everything. I am on the more specific side of things, not David Fincher level specific, but definitely on the more specific side of things. But I also love collaboration, and we try to make that very known. And I think people see that and have felt that before. So they're excited to come back and be a part of something where in the end, it doesn't feel like somebody's taking all the credit for, you know, their hard work and passion. And on top of that, it's, you know, it's a very audience-based thing that we do. We're putting out something for people to enjoy. That's the main purpose of it. And I think a lot of people are stoked to be a part of something like that as well. It's such like a quick turnaround audience thing too, you know, which is always nice to be in part of, because a lot of them do, you know, commercial work and things like that, where you never know who actually did it. and there's no, you know, audience entertainment portion to that. So they're all hungry to do narrative stuff like this as much as I am. So with those things combined, including be able to be like, you know, here's my other works. Are you down? You want to come play? You know, we're all trying to build a reel for ourselves. We do better work. We build more experience. And that definitely brings people in as well as much as, you know, and it's fun. These are also, you know, people that I know, friends of mine, and we all want to do this together, get on set, be a family, and create something that we can all have fun doing and be proud of in the end. And it's really just all those things that just, I think, bring us all together to, you know, bleed all over this thing to try to make it the best we possibly can while not making any money off of it or making a very reduced rate off of it or, in my case, losing a bunch of money off of it.
Right. The director is the lowest paid person
by
on the set,
far.
In this case.
But please buy the film when it comes on the store. Yeah, please so help many, a struggling director.
Patreon. So, you know, like you had a budget for this, but I'm assuming like an 80 person crew, you're not paying scale, right?
No.
Like is that kind of the way these types of things work where, you know, if you have some money, you can pay people a little bit, but I mean, they could go work on a commercial, you know, like a DP and get, you know, $2,500 a day or something totally. Like that. But if they're helping with your film, I'm assuming there's no way you can pay them that. Is it all about the passion, or do you sometimes have to just straight up pay people? Like, is it a combo?
Well, I mean, you have different people, like, you know, the editor or the DP or the composer, sound designer, producers, stunt coordinator, people like that who benefit off the film itself, period. But then you have like PAs who they're benefiting off the experience of being on the film and learning from it, but they need to be paid.
Right.
They need to be paid what they should be paid, because in the end, no one's going to IMDb to see who PA'd the film. I mean, they're getting a credit, but they're not getting that benefit from it as much as they're getting the education on set, but they're putting in hard work. So those guys, I try to pay properly as much as I possibly can. But I mean, PAs don't make $1,000 a day either. So, I mean, it's an easier one to carry that financial burden of. And then you have things like crafty and stuff like that you really can't skimp on. Anything involving safety, you can't skimp on. You know, with more of the creative collaborators, like the people I just mentioned, it's a matter of, hey, here's what I can do. I totally understand if, you know, it's not worth it to you, but if it is worth it to you and here's the script, if you want to come play, yeah, I would love that, you know? And to their credit, all of them were like, dude, let's do it. And a couple of them were even like, you know, and even keep that, what you're telling me, put it back into the film, you know, give it to those, the other crew members, you know, who deserve it. And you know, so it's also just years of building a network, you know, consciously building a network of collaborators like that have kind of come together for this film that has been like, all right, you know, Avengers Assemble to some extent. So it's that, and it's also, you know, it is a pretty low budget thing, so it lands in that sort of scale as far as unions and stuff go. So there's a different pay scale depending on what budget range you're in, so there's that as well.
That's really great to hear. I mean, there's a lot of that in our community too, of motion design. It's, you know, if you're doing a cool project that has, you know, like a good message or it's just interesting, it's actually not that hard to get people to just jump in and want to work on it without getting paid. And
totally. I mean, everybody wants to do something that they can be passionate about and proud of in the end. And, you know, I've always gone the route of, I mean, the honest, actual, like, objective route of, it's not just my film, it's all of our films. You know, it's my vision that you're all being kind enough to let me have and help me create. So I feel more, you know, appreciative of them than anything else, that they're actually taking their time and effort to allow me to, you know, see this vision realized. And you know, be in, to their credit, step aside when I'm like, no, it needs to be this way. And okay. Whereas, you know, they're not getting paid that much and it's their film too now. But they're, you know, we're all still coming on board and they're all, you know, putting their fingerprints on it and we're all collaborating. But, you know, it's everybody coming together to this script I wrote and they're all bringing it you know, that didn't exist. These characters didn't exist. This world didn't exist. And it's all just words on a paper. But now all these really talented people are coming together to, you know, help realize this and make it a thing that actually lives and breathes. And that's pretty amazing. And I feel pretty, you know, extremely appreciative to all of them for that sort of thing. But, you know, we're all wanting to come together to do something we're passionate about. And I think if you're not going the route of the you know, the greasy, hey, I'll give you a credit, you know, right. You could do it for exposure. Meanwhile, you know, there isn't going to be any probably, and you don't even know if it's going to be good in the end. You know, so just being really honest of here's what I can pay you. I'm going to do as much as I can. I'm going to make sure there's food. You know, that's really important. I'm going to make sure there's definitely going to be coffee. Don't worry about it. Yeah, craft services is going to be good. But this is what I can pay you. And, you know, this is what the project is. You know, if you're not interested, I totally understand.
That's the way to do it. Like, and I don't know. I think you've also got... you're so passionate about this stuff. It's clear that you really care about it. And I think that that probably helps you get people on board too. I want to ask you if, you know, like you seem like you've come up as a filmmaker, getting used to working without giant amounts of money, and using, you know, sort of like that DIY ethos, which is awesome. But your production value keeps getting better and better and better and better. And obviously a lot of that has to do with like the crews that you've been able to assemble and the people you've met. But let's just say that an investor said, you know, here's $1 million, Ryan. I want you to make that 17 minute ballistic film using $1 million. What would that have allowed you to do differently? I mean, would you have made it the same way or would you have done something differently?
Make ballistic for $1 million? I would have made it.
I mean, I don't know what the movie's about, so maybe that's
I would have made it for like a third of that and then saved the rest for my first feature. That's what I would have done.
Would have hired John Malkovich.
Yeah, I wouldn't have done much differently other than maybe add a couple of days. So we wouldn't have had some of the issues that we had as far as that goes. Because, you know, we didn't have enough days and I knew that going in, but it's like, you know, you want to accomplish this or not. It's that reaching a little too high, but you got to leap, you know, but you can still grab onto it. So it was that. So, I mean, I wouldn't have done that much different. I definitely wouldn't need $1 million for it for sure.
Yeah. But like, is there something that money gets you when you're making a film that, you know, is it just like more freedom as a director to say, well, you know what? It would actually be cool if there was a big boat there. Let's rent a boat.
Sure. I mean, you don't have as many restrictions, but I think not having restrictions is actually a restriction. You know, when you don't, when everybody's just saying yes to me over and over and over again, you know, I'm a dog off its leash and I'll just run rampant. But you know, if I only have this much room to play in, now I really have to be creative. Now I really have to think about, okay, why does my character have to do that? Because we only have this much money. So if I move that car over to there, cause we're shooting this old, like, junkyard. So there's all these cars everywhere. And I moved a bunch of cars around for specific reasons and staging or how I wanted to look or feel. And every time we touched a car, we had to pay for it. So if a character walked on a car, I'm paying for it. If we move a car from there to there, I'm paying for it. And we only have this much money. So I at first I'm like, move this car here, that car there, this car here, that car. And I'm just all this stuff. And then it's like, oh, we have to pay how much for doing all that? Never mind. Never mind. And then I had to get very specific. Right. Into this is the scene. This is what I'm trying to accomplish with the scene. This is what I want the audience to feel. This is what I want the characters to have to go through. Okay, you know what? Move that car, and that car. The rest can stay. And it becomes so much more intentional through those restrictions because you have to be much more thoughtful. You can't solve problems with money. And I imagine that's always the case. As you scale, the whole thing scales and you have to pay people a lot more. So, you know, what you did with $100,000, you know, $1 million isn't that far off from what a lot of friends are telling me because as you take that scale up, now everybody's getting paid a whole lot more and there's a whole lot more issues involved. More money, more problems. So it's not really $100,000 to $1 million jump, it sounds like. It sounds like it's more like $100,000 to $500,000 jump, like legitimately. which is a pretty big jump. But there are obviously some benefits to certain pieces of gear that we would have had that would have made life a lot easier, as far as, you know, lights that could have compete with the sun that would have helped us with some consistency problems, or those extra days. More than anything else, just having those extra days would have been huge,
right?
Because there would have been a bunch of things I wouldn't have had to throw out and rethink. It's hard to say that about a film that's finished, because it is what it is now. You know what I mean? Like, right. You start with this initial intention, but then the film pretty much says, no, I'm going to be this instead. And then you kind of follow it after that. You know, it just starts becoming its own thing. Even when I'm writing, I kind of feel like I start writing and then it starts dictating itself, you know, which sounds so pretentious and artsy. And I don't mean it to, but everybody I talk to says the same thing. So it seems like, it's not unique to me. It's pretty common that you just start writing and it just, oh yeah, of course they do this next. Of course this happens next. Of course this, those little lightning ideas. And it starts to it inevitably, oh yeah, yeah, it's headed there. Of course that's where it's headed. Why didn't I see that before? It's a really cool process of discovery while making the film. And then that happens in directing, and even the issues that come up. Okay, well, we can't do that, so let's do this. And that's just what it is now, you know? So to think back on what I would have done differently, would it have been better? I don't know. Or is it the restrictions that give it its charm that makes it what it is? You know, I mean, we haven't even put it out for the audience to react. They might just hate it. And then I'm like, right, man, yeah, I really wish I would have had that $1 million to go back. but I don't know. I feel like that might be a crappy answer to the question, but I mean, it's the honest one, I think. I like restrictions. I like not being able to do whatever I want, basically.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's sort of the story of Jaws, right?
Yeah, like,
they
totally
had the shark and it didn't work, and then it made it better because you never saw the shark. And you know, if they'd had more money, they would have just bought another shark maybe, and it wouldn't be, it wouldn't be Jaws.
Yeah, totally. And it's like something that Film Riot taught me, and even some of my short films, is like, I've talked about it on the show. If you have this universe of ideas and you want to write, say, just a sketch for Film Riot, and it's like, all right, write a sketch for Film Riot. It can be literally anything, any effect, anything you want, go. You'll just sit there like, maybe this, no. Well, maybe this, no. But if I say, hey, write a sketch for Film Riot, it has to be the flash effect from, say, Justice League. It has to take place in the office, and the only actors you have are Josh and Emily, and we have to shoot it tomorrow during the day. Well, okay, now I have a bunch of things, that I need to hit. And it's like, okay, right, well, let me think. Oh, you know what? What if Emily drank coffee for the first time and it made her hyperactive, and Josh came in and found it? So it's like, once you place, put yourself in a box, that's when you can really be a lot more creative consistently, because it's not just this vast expanse of anything, because it could literally be anything, and you need you need a starting point. You need that North Star, I suppose.
Yeah, that's amazing advice, really, for any creative endeavor. So I think the last thing I want to ask you, Ryan, is about, your goal to, to shoot and direct a feature film. And I've listened to you on other podcasts, and I've heard you mention this, and you mentioned this in this chat we just had, that you don't think you're quite ready, or you used to not think you were ready. And I'm curious, what is it that you feel like you don't quite have yet, that you still need to, enhance your abilities, or whatever, to be able to achieve that vision when you get that?
Well, I might be wrong, but I think I'm ready now. And I think for probably the last, for the past six, I mean, I agree with everyone that you're never truly ready, but I'm as ready as I'm going to get now, I think. And I've felt that way for the past 6 months or so. And Ballistic was sort of the final notch in the belt of me putting something together. The last few things that I thought I needed to really build my experience on, and then hopefully make something that I can be like, hey, look, this is what I just did, and here are the ideas I now have. I have a few treatments. I'm going to start pitching after Ballistic comes out, and I can breathe in and out again and have some time. Right. But before, it was, it was the lack of experience. It was the lack of understanding of how to run a crew. I mean, in LA, like I said, we had 85, I think it was, 80 or 85 people on set. And as the director, you're running that. And if you're not, somebody else is seeing that you're not, or that you're drowning amidst all that, you know, madness, and they start to run roughshod over you and taking over, and that's not good because now you're going to start losing your crew and you're going to start losing your film. So it's something that's hard to command when you need to and back off when you need to. It's a weird, very interesting and fun sort of dynamic, you know, even when you have your stunt coordinators and your producers and your cinematographer, knowing when to push and when to let go, when to collaborate, when to stand firm. You know, it's a bunch of marriages all at once. You just have a bunch of wives pretty much. And or husbands, whatever it is. I could be the wife, I don't know. So, you know, figuring all that out, you know, was really important, I think. And also just gaining the experience of how to tell the story and how to be the keeper of the story and how to engage the audience was really important to me because, like I said, it's a bunch of people coming together, trusting you that in the end, this is going to be something that we're all proud of. Because even when we're offset, like they're there to help make this thing and make it as best as we can be. But now production's done and I'm in post-production with just me and my editor and they're not a part of it anymore. And they're just trusting that now everything that we just put together, even if what we shot was amazing, I could totally screw it up in post. So now they're trusting me to go off by myself and be the keeper of this thing that we all just bled into for this a period of time. And I don't take that lightly. So I didn't want it to be something that I'm just jumping into because I'm impatient and I want to make my films. I wanted it to be something where I was ready to make our films. And, you know, it'd be worthwhile for the people that came together to help me make our films. So that was like my main thinking. And it's also something where it's like, you know, I really enjoy telling short stories and giving people an experience that way and entertaining them that way. So that was a nice, you know, appetizer while waiting for the main meal, you know, so that held me over while I, you know, prepped myself to not only feel like I'm ready experience wise, but have an idea where I'm like, yes, this is it. I have to make this. This is the film that I have to make. Nobody else can make this. It has to be me. And now I have like three of those that I feel like would be, you know, the one that I would be happy to be my first feature. But that's only been over the past maybe year that I've had. I had one, and then 6 months ago I had another, and recently I had a third. So that was really important to me too, that I'm not just jumping out and putting something out there, because it's also very public. My career has been very public. So putting out a very meh film that maybe drowns a little bit wasn't really something that was very interesting to me. So I wanted to make sure, you know, my first step into that world was going to be as strong as it could possibly be. And who knows, it could still fail. You never know. It's gambling no matter what. But I wanted to stack the odds in my favor as much as possible.
Definitely check out Film Riot's YouTube channel to see their films and the incredible behind-the-scenes stuff they post. It's like a crash course in production, and if you're a gearhead, you will really love it. Film Riot also has a podcast, so if you want more filmmaking talk in your ears, check that out too. We will link to Ballistic and anything else we talked about in the show notes at schoolofmotion.com, and I want to thank Ryan for being such a good dude and so generous with his time. His passion is really contagious, and talking with him makes me just want to go create something, and I hope it made you feel the same way. Thanks so much for listening. Until next time.